That's a very interesting background to have. Civil War and Reconstruction. For those of you outside this country or who were not taught history, the North and the South in this country had a war. 600,000 people died so that black men could be free. One of the tactics of that war, I believe it was Stonewall Jackson. I may be wrong on that. But anyways, it was just burn the whole damn South down. He went on a path that he and the Grant had figured. And every town he went to, they burned it to the ground and they killed all the livestock. And they took of anything valuable. So obviously, when we won, one of the things that we had to do was go and rebuild everything that we destroyed. And that's why it was the Reconstruction. And during that time of Reconstruction, the military was in charge. They didn't have any mayors, governors, no nothing.
Serious subject I'd like to talk about today. I'm here in Philadelphia, the National Constitution Center, the city and the place where the story of we the people began. It's a story that's neither simple nor straightforward. That's because the story is the sum of our parts, and all those parts are fundamentally human. And being human is to be imperfect, driven by appetite and ambition, as much as by goodness and grace. But some things in America should be simple and straightforward. Perhaps the most important of those things, the most fundamental of those things, is the right to vote. The right to vote freely. The right to vote freely, the right to vote fairly, the right to have your vote counted. The democratic threshold is liberty. With it, anything's possible. Without it, nothing, nothing. And for our democracy and the work and to deliver our work and our people, it's up to all of us to protect that right. This is a test of our time, what I'm here to talk about today. Just think about the past election. A 102-year-old woman in Arkansas, who voted for the first time on the very spot she once picked cotton. A 94-year-old woman in Michigan voted early and in person in her 72nd consecutive election.
So as I was watching this, he's been going on now for about a minute or two. I'm not seeing anything of fear. I'm not seeing anything that says, oh, I'm stressed. And as you saw him come out, the clown, it was a concert. You got the political heavyweights in this room. They're all cheering. They're all smiley. It didn't seem like there was defeat there. I don't know what's going on behind the scenes in Pennsylvania. We all know that they've initiated an audit. But if who we think of as the enemy isn't sweating, and it's like a little victory concert where they all got together, flex their muscles, and they're still smiley. It's like, I don't think this is going to go well. It just doesn't seem like it's going to be a good victory for the American people of getting a fair audit, which if you actually won, shouldn't stress you out. It would shut people like me up.
Attorney General Merrick Garland announced that the United States Department of Justice is going to be using its authorities to challenge the onslaught of state laws undermining voting rights in old and new ways. Focus will be on dismantling racially discriminatory laws like the recent challenge to Georgia's vicious anti-voting law. The Department of Justice will do so with a voting rights division that, at my request, is doubling its size and enforcement staff. While this broad assault against voting rights is not unprecedented, it's taking on a new and literally pernicious forms. It's no longer just about who gets to vote or making it easier for eligible voters to vote. It's about who gets to count the vote. Who gets to count whether or not your vote counted at all. It's about moving from independent election administrators who work for the people to polarized state legislatures and partisan actors who work for political parties. To me, this is simple. This is election subversion. It's the most dangerous threat to voting and the integrity of free and fair elections in our history. Never before have they decided who gets to count what votes count. Some state legislators want to make it harder for you to vote. And if you vote, they want to be able to tell you your vote doesn't count for any reason they make up. They want the ability to reject the final count and ignore the will of the people if their preferred candidate loses. And they're trying, not only targeting people of color, they're targeting voters of all races and backgrounds. Just with a simple target. Who did not vote for them? That's the target. It's unconscionable. I mean, really, it's hard to declare just how critical this is.
So Beth, this is about the first time we see him go off script as far as really try and put his emotional angst into it. And this is shortly after he says it's about who gets to count the vote. So this stress is coming from that statement as he repeated it. And here he actually stops talking. He had his hands up in the air. He is looking for that emotional word that will give the weight to what he's trying to portray to these people. It's about who counts it.
It's simply unconscionable. We've got to shore up our election system and address the threats to election subversion, not just from abroad, which I spent time with Putin talking about, but from home. From home. We must ask those who represent us at the federal, state, and local levels, will you deny the will of the people? Will you ignore their voices? We have to ask, are you on the side of truth or lies, fact or fiction, justice or injustice, democracy or autocracy? That's what it's coming down to. Which brings me perhaps the most important thing we have to do. We have to forge a coalition of Americans of every background and political party, the advocates, the students, the faith leaders, the labor leaders, the business executives.
All right, so the stress has kicked up ever since he started with it's about who counts the votes. His voice is being raised. He's swinging a little bit more wildly. You see more expression. So that's obviously the stressor about who counts these votes. And because of the confidence that we saw in the beginning of this, and he goes in to say that the DOJ is expanding their division, or they're creating a division for voting rights, and that they're going to be going after all of these states that are subverting their ability, apparently, to count the vote, or who controls the count of the vote. And I'm assuming that's where that confidence is coming from in the beginning, because they're just going to send out the might of the federal DOJ to get everyone back in line. And they have the Supreme Court on their side. And I'm guessing they don't have as much control over Pennsylvania as they would like, because if that were the case, we would not be seeing this reaction.
If you'd like to learn more about analysing body language, there is a video course available on Mandy's website for Gold subscribers, where Mandy teaches more about her techniques of deception detection. There's also other content such as the Crime Series and Interesting Mind Series available to both Gold and Silver subscribers.
If you like it, please share and subscribe. Thanks for watching.
I would like to thank the sponsor of this video, Fero. Fero is one of the few cryptocurrency projects that I respect. And like most other cryptocurrencies, Fero is focused on safeguarding your financial privacy without compromising on trustlessness, which means no third parties are required and transactions are private by default. Fero also has an exciting roadmap to look forward to. Features such as Instant Send, where payments can both be sent and confirmed within seconds. There's also Elysium, which adds tokenization functionality similar to Ethereum, but it also enables these assets to enjoy Fero's privacy technology. There's many more things on the roadmap, and if you'd like to learn more, head over to Fero.org.